Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Mike Posner. I'm the Assistant Secretary of State here in the Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. And my terrific assignment here is really to introduce the introducer, Hannah Rosenthal, who's going to introduce Deborah Lipstadt. I just want to say, by way of introduction, three very quick things. One is that I've worked for the last 30-some years in the human rights world, and one of the things that I think we've learned in a broad sense, and it's very much derivative of this event and the experience of the Eichmann trial, is that for societies that are traumatized, for groups that are traumatized, it's critically important that there be a truth-telling exercise, and that as a way of moving forward and having the ability to create real democratic space, there needs to be both an exercise of some sort that reveals the truth and an acknowledgement to the aggrieved that a wrongdoing occurred. This is a concept, the concept, broadly speaking, of accountability as a piece of reconciliation that we've learned in very different ways in different places. But I think it's fair to say that the experience of the Holocaust and the experience of trying to address the horrors of the Holocaust, both at Nuremberg and then in the Eichmann trial, have really led the way. Second thing I want to say is that we in this State Department and in the Obama administration are absolutely committed to what is really an ongoing struggle to address the challenges that we still face in the world in dealing with the worst forms of discrimination, including anti-Semitism, which continues to be a real problem in our world today. And that leads me to my third point, which is really to say that I couldn't be prouder of this administration for having appointed Hannah Rosenthal as our special envoy with a particular focus on raising the profile of anti-Semitism as a central focus of our foreign policy. It is something that Hannah does as well as any human being on Earth, and we are really proud to have her with us. Hannah and I are sort of the same vintage, and I think 50 years ago, we were both in homes where the Eichmann trial was a riveting experience. Hannah, 10 years old, and the daughter of a Holocaust survivor, understood intuitively, and because of her own family's experience, how profoundly important this event was. What's so remarkable is how it also began to open the doors and open the eyes to people all over the world to recognize the enormity of what had happened in the Holocaust. And I'm thrilled that Hannah works with me, and Hannah will introduce our distinguished author and speaker. Thanks.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you all for coming. This is an important event. As Mike just mentioned, I do remember 50 years ago today, sitting and watching my grainy, little, tiny, black and white television with my father. I can almost smell his cigar smoke as he puffed and puffed and grunted at what was being said and how well he knew it. I also want to be sure to welcome the diplomats that are here. We have 14 diplomats here representing Morocco and Kosovo and New Zealand and Turkey and Austria and Greece and Lithuania and Honduras, Ukraine, and Israel. And I get the honor of introducing Professor Deborah Lipstadt, the Dorot Professor of Modern Jewish History and Holocaust Studies at Emory. And there are some people here from Emory. Welcome. I hope you all got a chance to see the New York Times over the weekend. In the book review section, Deborah's book is reviewed, wonderfully reviewed, and I quelled. I loved reading it, and particularly knowing I was going to get to hear her talk about the trial and her book today. So if you haven't seen it, you know how to Google. Do it. Deborah provides an important review of the power that the Eichmann trial had, not just on those of us sitting and watching the television and knowing and having a sense it was a transformative moment, but tells the story of how it was that Eichmann was able to escape an American POW camp, how he got help from the Red Cross and the Catholic Church in getting to Argentina, where he lived as Ricardo Clement. His passport was just discovered in some file over the last couple of years, and when I was in Argentina several months ago, I got a chance to see it. And it is a profound thing to see the picture of Adolf Eichmann with the name Ricardo Clement. He was captured by the Israelis in Argentina in 1960, and of course, 50 years ago today, the Eichmann trials began in Israel. I have known Deborah for a while and followed not only her scholarship, but her courage, especially during the trial when Holocaust denier David Irving was accusing her of libel because she referred to him as a Holocaust denier. It was a very public, a very expensive, a very trying trial. It took a long time, and of course, Deborah prevailed, but the price that was paid to go through that process was enormous, and I have unbelievable regard for your strength, your tenacity, and your courage in being firm in your beliefs. She's a champion of historical truth and a powerful voice against anti-Semitism and all forms of hatred here and abroad, and it is my honor to introduce Professor Deborah Lipstadt.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Secretary Posner, for your wise and perceptive words. And thank you, Hannah, for making this possible when we were together at a conference on Holocaust denial in Ireland. And you said to me, I want you to come and speak at the State Department. And I said, well, I have the book on the Eichmann trial coming up. And you said, come and speak on April 11th, the day of the beginning of the trial. I said, I agreed that was a terrific time to come. And only afterwards, when someone asked me when I was coming to speak at the State Department, I said April 11th, did it dawn on me, and the mind works in funny ways, that that's also the anniversary of the decision in my own trial. So these two events come together on a very important day. Hannah's invitation here has particular significance, because this is not just any venue, this is the State Department. And it marks, it's an important moment, because as I shall argue, and even as Secretary Posner said in his introductory remarks, this trial put a human face on genocide. And to speak in an institution which is charged by our nation with monitoring, preventing, and responding to the terrible acts of genocide, which are all too frequent in our times, has special meaning for me. Moreover, to stand before an audience, many of whom were about to be furloughed, and we were very glad you weren't, which is composed in great measure of people who work for the federal government, is also moving. Because this book is dedicated to three people who worked for a federal institution. And I'd like, it's appropriate because there are people here from the Holocaust Museum, to read that dedication. Much of the work on this book was done while I was the Judith B. and Burton P. Resnick Invitational Scholar at the Center for Advanced Holocaust Studies of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. My stay had all the ingredients scholars savor: outstanding colleagues, extensive scholarly resources, and the freedom to do one's own work. Then tragedy struck. At noon on June 10th, 2009, Special Officer Stephen Tyrone Johns, a long-term guard at the USHMM and a man beloved by the museum staff, saw an elderly man approaching the museum. Eager to be of help, this was his hallmark, Special Officer Johns reached out and pushed open the heavy glass door. Instead of entering, the man, an 88-year-old racist, anti-Semite, and Holocaust denier, raised a rifle from beneath his coat and shot Stephen Tyrone Johns. He was murdered trying to do a kindness. Most mornings, including that very day, when I arrived at the museum, Special Officer Johns would be there. Often he would kid me about the piles of books I always had in tow. He seemed to have a friendly word for everyone. I had passed his station on my way to give a lecture a few moments before this incident and saw him welcoming people to the museum. The museum opened 2 days later. The staff was unsure if people would be too frightened to return. Shortly before the opening, I went outside to see if anyone was there. I fought back the tears when I saw the crowd. The line stretched around the block and down the street. It was significantly longer than for a normal June day. I heard people say that they were there in order to demonstrate that the bigots could not frighten them away. They had come precisely because the shooter wanted to keep them away. Visiting an institution dedicated to teaching about the Holocaust and fighting genocide had become an act of defiance. It is with deep gratitude and sadness that I dedicate this book to the memory of Special Officer Johns and to the two officers whose quick response prevented this tragedy from assuming far greater proportions. Special Officer Johns' kindness and Special Officers Harry Weeks and Jason Mack McKinston's sheer professionalism are the hallmarks of this institution. We who were there, the thousands of people who visit on a daily basis, and the multitudes who benefit from its myriad of activities owe them and the museum's entire staff more than can be imagined. This is a very small token of that gratitude. On May 23rd, David Ben-Gurion entered the Israeli Knesset for what was to be a normal, run-of-the-mill budgetary debate. Nothing is normal and run-of-the-mill in the Knesset even 50 years ago, but word had spread that he was coming to make some sort of special announcement. But miracle of miracles, people did not know what the announcement was going to be, and any of you who are familiar with Israeli society know that indeed is a miracle. He stood up, and in two sentences, and count the words, it depends if you're counting in Hebrew or in English, but it's about 50 words, he announced that Israel had gained access to, that in Israel's hands were, the verbiage was, the verb usage, which is a little bit murky as it was designed to be, the man who was responsible, greatly responsible for the final solution, Adolf Eichmann, and that he would be put on trial in Israel under the auspices or under the 1950 Israeli law against Nazis and their collaborators. How had he been found? Hannah already told you how he escaped to Argentina using a, with IRC and Catholic Church support. They were helping many people get out of Europe, rather, many war criminals. Argentina was very happy to have these people. There was a debate in Argentina about the ethnic and color makeup of the population. These were quote-unquote white Europeans with education, and their resume, which included war crimes, was immaterial to the Argentinians. It wasn't as if they were seeking them out, but that didn't matter. They brought other things which made them seem like welcome immigrants. Now, it's striking. Israel had heard that he was possibly in Argentina, but Isser Harel, the head of Israeli security services then, didn't really react. He had a limited staff, a limited budget, and he felt his attention, his energies, his staff's energies should be dedicated to contemporary enemies of the Jewish state and not to enemies who had tried to do it, who had done Jews, one-third of the Jewish population, had helped murder one-third of the Jewish population 15 years or even earlier, as soon as had murdered them in the 40s. He felt we have enemies in the 50s, we have enemies now, that's who we should focus on. Fritz Bauer, a German Jew who had escaped Germany after a stint in a concentration camp in the 30s, gone to Denmark, and then when the Germans came close to Denmark, went to Sweden, was very close with Willy Brandt, was persuaded by Willy Brandt to come back to Germany to help set up a democratic judiciary. Fritz Bauer learned from a Jew living in Argentina who had hidden his Jewish identity. It's a complicated story and a fascinating story. It's in the book. His daughter was dating Eichmann's son. And Eichmann's son came for dinner and announced they should have killed all of them, et cetera. And then the man didn't know the name Eichmann. The son had kept his father's name. And he thought Ricardo Clement, or he said Ricardo Clement was his uncle. But then the man read the name Eichmann in the Argentinian German language newspaper, put two and two together, let Fritz Bauer know. Fritz Bauer, and we now know that many Germans knew exactly who Eichmann was. It was no secret. It was a secret, but it was known. The Argentinian police knew he was there. He was especially low. Even other Nazi war criminals didn't want to have too much to do with Adolf Eichmann because he was seen as, some of you might know the word Prost, he was seen as very common. He was seen as having real blood on his hands, where others felt they were just sort of paper pushers and they weren't as close to the killings as he was. But Bauer knew that if he let the German embassy in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, know that Eichmann was there, that someone would tip Eichmann off and he would escape. And it had happened with Mengele, and Fritz Bauer, with the cooperation of the president of the state of Hesse, let the Israelis know that they had good reason to believe that Eichmann was in Argentina. And the Israelis did nothing. It took a while for Isser Harel to find someone who happened to be going to Argentina anyway, who said, go and see if you can find this guy, if this is really the guy. They were very dubious when they drove past the house where he was supposed to live. It was a ramshackled cinder block house with no running water, no electricity. And they said this could not be the home of the man who had a great played a great role in the murder of the Jewish people. He wouldn't be living like this. Bauer then came on an official state visit to Israel, and Isser Harel, he was meeting the Attorney General, and Isser Harel was summoned to a meeting. Isser Harel was not used to be summoned by anyone but Ben-Gurion, so he came with a sort of, wasn't very happy about going, but at that meeting, Bauer gave him information, which is now coming out. We now have a sense of what that information was, confirming that this indeed, Ricardo Clement was indeed Adolf Eichmann. At that point, Isser Harel went directly to Ben-Gurion, I think at Steh Boker, at the kibbutz where Ben-Gurion spent a lot of his time. And he told him, and Ben-Gurion did something which I think hasn't really been significantly recognized in Ben-Gurion's career. He could have said to Harel, make him disappear. He comes home every night on the bus, he walks to a relatively isolated place, let him end up in a ditch, let him end up, he wouldn't even have told him, just take care of it. Instead, Ben-Gurion said, bring him here and we will put him on trial. Ben-Gurion didn't sense at that early point that he was and will educate the next generation. That all came later. But he had a sense of the importance of a trial. He had a sense of the importance of Israel trying this man. And that's indeed what happened. The Israelis captured him, kidnapped him, depending how you want to describe it, brought him, drugged him, got him on an El Al plane, put him in an El Al steward's uniform, put him on the plane, brought him to Israel, took him to the prison in Akko, where he was held, and Isser Harel went to Jerusalem to tell Ben-Gurion that he was here. Harel said to Ben-Gurion, don't say anything for a couple of days, because I still have operatives in Argentina who are breaking down the safe house where we kept him, returning the cars we rented, hiding as much of the record of our being there. Of course, what Harel didn't know is the Argentinian police had known that a bunch of Israelis had arrived about 10 days earlier and they had wondered what they were doing there, and it's all in the police records, but so be it. And I need to give them time to get out of Argentina. And Ben-Gurion said, how many people already know that Eichmann is in our hands and in Israel? And so Harel said about 50, because the entire El Al staff of the plane, the pilots, and Ben-Gurion said, we wait 2 days, the whole nation will know, you know, so. Ben-Gurion knew his people. So Ben-Gurion announced that afternoon he would be making, or the next day he would be making a special announcement at the Knesset. The reaction was in Israel was overwhelming. No one quite knows if the Knesset immediately burst into applause or there was a moment of silence. You get lots of different reports, but there was this sense both in the Knesset and then spilling out over onto the street, Eichmann biyadenu, Eichmann is in our hands. I've had many friends who grew up in Israel who remember their parents who were survivors, the emotions with which they reacted to the news. What a powerful, personal, powerful moment it was for them. Now, immediately, of course, Argentina decided to protest in the UN. And that was a very complicated affair, in part because the Argentinian ambassador to the UN had been a very strong supporter of the fascists. He loved Mussolini, even loved the National Socialists in Germany. And during the debate, Golda Meir came to the UN to represent Israel. And during the debate, the Argentinian ambassador said, look, we could have tracked down these Nazi war criminals, but we could have also tracked down the Jewish refugees who were in our country quasi-legally, at which point Golda Meir, you could almost, when you look at the tapes, you can see her almost exploding, but she said she was shocked at this comparison between the two groups. And at one point, it looked like the Security Council might actually vote that Israel should return Eichmann to Argentina, where he was illegally. Israel kept saying, look, we know that we don't have him, it's quasi-legal, but he was in your country illegally. No one was bringing him to trial, and we got him, and now we're interested in trying him. Then the Soviets announced that they might call for the resumption of the Nuremberg tribunals, which was their right, because part of the Nuremberg decision was that you could have successor trials. And certainly no one wanted that. And at this point, the United States was going to support a resolution to return Eichmann to the Argentinians. This was also the spring of 1960, and the presidential race was beginning to take shape. And apparently, Richard Nixon called Ambassador Henry Cabot Lodge and asked if he was still interested in being on the ticket. So he said yes, and Nixon said, make this go away. And that has been reported by reliable people who were present and who knew of the conversation. So Henry Cabot Lodge, Ambassador Lodge, forged a compromise. As one pundit put it, Argentina got its apology and Israel got its man. Israel apologized to the Argentinians and Israel kept Eichmann. And it took a while till Israel repaired relations with Argentina. The people who bore the brunt of this event really was the Argentinian Jewish community, which lived, felt insecure. One woman, in fact, was killed, and there were attacks, and felt very moved and unnerved by this event. But of course, at that point, an international debate erupted. All the press of the world, certainly the European press, the North American press, the South American press, began to debate this. And many people, the Washington Post, New York Times, just to name two important media outlets in our country, were, particularly the Post in particular, was strongly against Israel holding a trial. Many argued, and including the Post and the Times, others, that this was victor's justice, A. B, that Israel didn't exist at the time, so how could it conduct a trial of this man? And the crimes were not committed against Israeli citizens. Others asked, could Eichmann get a fair trial, given that the judges would all be Israelis and Jews? Many people argued it should be held in an international court or held in Germany. Now, the response that Israel and others gave to the critics, including some Argentinian newspapers, was that to talk about victor's justice, you have to talk about Nuremberg, too, because Nuremberg was also victor's justice. Why wasn't that more of an issue at that time and not an issue now? The crime against humanity as a concept didn't exist at that time. Well, if it's wrong to murder one person, ipso facto, it's clear that it's wrong to murder or participate in the murder of millions. Regarding the existence of Israel and the political identity of the victims, it was Hannah Arendt who said it most clearly that she had very, very little good to say about this trial, but in this point she found this criticism so formalistic and out of touch with reality that it shouldn't even be dealt with. That Israel was the place where the greatest number of survivors lived, Israel was the place where the people whose family had been directly touched by this, and Israel was the proper place to put to hold it. Moreover, again, as many of you who are in this building know, and others as well, there was no international court to hold the trial. There was an international court, but it only adjudicated cases between nations. There was no ICC, International Criminal Court, at that time. Germany had no, West Germany had no desire to hold this trial. In fact, Adenauer wanted to stay as far away from this trial as possible, in part because he knew it would generate a discussion, which already was going on, but even more so, about all the former Nazis, including his own, so to speak, chief of staff, Hans Globke, who were having very good careers and very beneficial careers in the post-Third Reich period. In fact, Adenauer had said to the Bundestag in 1952 that it's time to get over, quote, the sniffing out of the past. He wanted to move forward. Now, he had a strange ally in this on some level, Ben-Gurion, because Ben-Gurion was at this point in the stage of developing relations with Germany. Germany was beginning to, he was trying to get an arms deal with Germany. Eventually, there were going to be diplomatic relations. And Ben-Gurion also didn't want this didn't want the association of West Germany with Nazi Germany. And in fact, when Gideon Hausner, and I'll talk about him in just a moment, but when he sends Ben-Gurion his opening speech a few days before the beginning of the trial, Ben-Gurion sends it back with a few corrections, and the only main correction was, please refer not to Germany, but to Nazi Germany. So people will not conflate the two Germanies. So, West Germany had no desire to hold it. So Israel was really the only country, the only place interested in doing it. So then there were all sorts of logistics. And the head of Ben-Gurion's office was a man named Teddy Kollek, who would go on to be famous for really developing Jerusalem into the city that it is. And Teddy Kollek had to work out the logistics of the trial. Where should it be? Israel had no courtroom that was large enough. The courtrooms were all in, some of you know, Jerusalem, the Russian compound, which was then older and more decrepit. Today it's nicer, but it was pretty old and decrepit. So Teddy Kollek had to find a place. At that point, they were under construction, right behind, actually essentially a block behind the Knesset, was a building called Beit Ha'am, the House of the People. It was supposed to be a cultural center, was under construction. And Kollek went to the builders and said, look, I'm going to need this in a year's time for a trial. Will it be ready? They said yes, and again, miracles of miracles, it was ready. But then who was going to defend Eichmann? There were some Israeli lawyers who stepped forward, who said, look, we have no desire, we have no support for this man in any manner, shape, or form, but if it's going to be a fair trial, he has to have a defense. The Attorney General and Minister of Justice were very nervous about this. This was shortly after Kastner, who was accused of being, collaborating with the Nazis on the ransom and the saving of Hungarian Jews, had been murdered on the streets of Tel Aviv outside his home. And they were afraid that if they appointed an Israeli lawyer to defend Eichmann, that somebody would be so crazed, maybe with grief, maybe distraught over what happened to their family, and would fail to differentiate between the defendant and the representative of the defendant. So they did not want that. But they also did not want someone who had been a member of the Nazi Party to come and represent and to defend Eichmann. So the Eichmann family proposed a man named Servatius, Dr. Servatius, who had defended some of the defendants at Nuremberg, had not been a member of the Nazi Party. He was acceptable to the he was acceptable to the Israelis. But then came the question of who's going to pay him. Generally, West German government, paid for, if a German was accused of war crimes outside of Germany, the German government paid for that person's defense. Just on the basis of one of its citizens was accused of a crime representing the government, it was their responsibility to pay. Adenauer wanted nothing to do with Eichmann. They refused to pay. They said, because he escaped from Germany, he escaped under an assumed name, we have no responsibility to pay. So Israel ended up paying $30,000 for Eichmann's defense. Who was going to be prosecutor? Israel had just gotten a new attorney general named Gideon Hausner. Gideon Hausner had been the third choice for attorney general, and political reasons, the first two choices had been eliminated. he was a commercial lawyer. He hadn't really ever tried, as far as I know, a criminal case. But Gideon Hausner insisted that he was going to present Israel's case. Now, who's going to be the judge? Officially, because this trial was going to take place in Jerusalem, the judge should have been the head of, according to Israeli law, the head of the Israeli district court, a man named Judge Halevi. Well, Judge Halevi had been the judge in the Kastner trial, and people begged Halevi to step aside because they said you're going to compromise, in which Kastner was charged with collaborating. Kastner was charged some with libel for calling him a collaborator. And Halevi refused to step aside, and he said, the only reason you're pushing me aside is I'm not a member of labor, I'm a Likud, what today we would call Likud. So there was the fight there, so the Israeli Knesset, in a sort of dubious act, because it's sort of ex post facto, passed the law saying that the head of the tribunal has to be a member of the Israeli High Court, the equivalent of our Supreme Court, Beit Mishpat Elyon, and that was Justice Landau, who was still alive, is 99 years old. And that Halevi would be one of the judges, and Judge Raveh from the Tel Aviv District Court would be the third. They were all German-born, so they knew German fluently, and they were very much respected judges. Now, Gideon Hausner's job was to put together a case. And he looked back at Nuremberg. He read the entire transcripts of the Nuremberg Tribunal, and he said the problem with the Nuremberg tribunals, there were a number of cases, was that they failed to capture the emotions and the imagination of the world. Now, part that was because when they were held in 1946, immediately after the war, Europe is still in shambles, people are putting their lives back together. He determined that he wanted to capture the imagination of the world. And at the suggestion of a woman, Rachel Auerbach, who worked at Yad Vashem, who was apparently a difficult person to get along with, she was a survivor of the Warsaw Ghetto. She had been one of those who had found the records of the, who knew where the records of the Warsaw Ghetto were and helped them be found. But she insisted, she said, you must call survivors, you must tell the story. And she actually said, just call from the time of the war. But Hausner made a critical decision, not from a legal point of view, but from a historical point of view. Hausner determined that he was going to tell the story of the final solution, the attempt to annihilate European Jewry, both with the documents that had been introduced at Nuremberg, but also with survivors. And he was going to have people, he was going to put a face, as I said earlier, a human face on genocide by having these people in the witness box. And the Israeli perception, much of the world's perception at this time, which we now historically was wrong, was that Eichmann was the person in charge of the final solution. So his intention was to tell the whole story. So people who had no direct connection with Eichmann would be in the witness box telling their story. And he planned this out with the witnesses and then parallel documents as well. So once the trial is set, things begin to move forward, and it opens approximately a year, April 11th, 1961, in Jerusalem, right after Passover of that year. Passover was early that year. It's either early or late. It's never on time, but that's for another lecture. In contrast to Nuremberg, here the final solution was the centerpiece. The war against the Jews was the main crime for which Eichmann was being brought to trial. There were other crimes against other peoples, his crimes against all sorts of other things that he did were there too, but they were certainly secondary, if not tertiary, if not more so, in importance. It was the crime against the Jews. At Nuremberg, the crimes against the Jews had been a sidebar, a subset of the legal proceeding. So that immediately made this extensively different in many, in that respect. So Hausner begins to call witnesses and at the same time to introduce documents. But before he does that, at the very opening, Dr. Servatius stands up and he questions Israel's legal right to hold this trial. And for 2 days, Hausner goes on citing all sorts of cases from the United States, cases from Great Britain, cases from different parts of Europe, which showed that it was immaterial how a defendant came into the hands of the prosecuting group, that you could still then go and charge him with this crime. The Israeli press became very, very ill at ease and very nervous and impatient And saying, what do we need a case from Idaho to prove our right to try this man? But it really turned a lot of people around, showing that in Israel's determination to show that international law, it felt that it was relying on international law to try this case. And then, of course, came the time for Hausner's opening speech. And I would argue that, and I know there's some Israelis here, that Israelis who were born long after this trial, many of them still know that opening a paragraph of his trial where he said, I don't stand alone before you. I stand with 6 million. And today we come to charge a man who was an heir of Pharaoh, of Haman, of Khmelnytsky. And then he said, and we turn and we say, Jacques Hughes. And I've had many Israelis born long after the trial, when I told them I was writing this book, who just recited it from memory. He made the argument that Eichmann was the CEO of the final solution. He wasn't. He was one of the COOs, to use contemporary terms. He was one of the chief operating officers. We can trace to Eichmann probably the death of a million and a half Jews. In terms of the deportations, in terms of the roundups, but there were places where he wasn't involved. That wasn't something that Hausner recognized, so the case really told the entire story of the final solution. And he started from the beginning and worked his way through. And in the testimony of the victims, many of these people had spoken before. But I would argue from reading extensive reports, certainly the Israeli press, the American press, the British press, European press, and memoirs of people from that period, it was as if it was the first time it was being heard. We know that survivors had spoken in the 50s. The myth was, when I began this, I was under the impression as well, that there had been silence till the Eichmann trial, and suddenly at the Eichmann trial, survivors began to speak out. Not true. People had spoken out. The difference was the world hadn't listened. And that's what happened at this trial. The world began to listen. There were more reporters present in Jerusalem when this trial opened than had been at Nuremberg. Then we had the Sputnik shot and the Bay of Pigs, so many of them went off to cover these other things, but certainly at the beginning, they were there en masse. And the stories that they tell are riveting. And they tell it in the first person singular. And we live now, and many of the people in this room, I know there are people here from the Holocaust Museum, people from other places who work in this area, that deal with other acts of genocide. You know that there is nothing more powerful than the person who can speak in the first person singular, who can say, this is my story, I was there, this is what happened to me. And that's what you heard day after day after day at the trial. You heard stories of shootings, people talking about fountains of blood, which Eichmann had spoken about as well. And you heard, it wasn't just mass stories of what happened to numerous people, but you also heard stories of what happened to individuals. Let me read to you a story from the testimony of George Wellers. Excuse me, yes. From France. As you know, if you know about the French deportations, you know that at one point many of the children were separated from their parents and held to be deported. And Professor George Weller's description described what happened in July 42 at Drancy, when the camp outside Paris, where some of these children were held without their parents. They slept over 100 to a room on straw mattresses on the ground, mattresses which were filthy, disgusting, and full of vermin. Wellers was there with Rene Blum, the brother of Leon Blum, to see the children. And there was one, he told the story of one boy, and when I read this testimony, it sits with me, and I include it in the book. They spoke with one boy who was, quote, remarkably handsome, with a face which was very intelligent. He wore clothes which must have been very good quality, rather stylish, but in a pitiful condition. One foot was bare. When Wellers and Blum asked the little boy about his parents, he said, my father goes to the office and mummy plays the piano. They reassured him that he would soon rejoin his parents, even though both of them knew that he would soon be on a transport to Auschwitz. The little boy showed them a biscuit that he was saving for his mother when they were reunited. Blum described bending over the little boy, who looked very happy and very engaging. He took his face in his hands and wanted to stroke the little boy's head. And at that moment, the child, who only a moment ago had been so happy, burst into tears. And the 4,000 children who were rounded up were deported to Auschwitz shortly thereafter. For me, the stories certainly of the mass deportations had a tremendous impact, but the stories of the individuals, which Hausner insisted that be told in the first person singular, were even more powerful. There was the story of the Hungarian deportation, which of course, you know, it's all tragic, but is doubly tragic because it comes at the end. The Hungarian deportation comes in the spring of 44, when the Russians are already approaching Hungary. Parts of the Soviet Union have already been liberated. We will soon land in Normandy. Many of the deportations take place after Normandy. The Americans have landed in Italy, are moving up the coast. It's finished for the Germans. It's finished. And with a speed and an intensity, they murder close to 500,000 Hungarian Jews. And one woman testified, Margaret Reich, and I'll just read a little bit of her testimony. She came to the witness box and she described, she had with her a letter that her husband had written to her and thrown from the train when he was deported to Auschwitz. And he scrawled on the outside, "Blessed be the hand which posts this letter." And some hand did post this letter. We have no idea who it was. And when she took the stand, she couldn't read the letter, so she gave it to Hausner's assistant, Gabi Bach, who goes on to be a member of the High Court in Israel. And Gabi Bach read it, and he broke down in the middle and had to stop reading. "My dear wife and children, we are setting out on a very long journey. I shall somehow bear my fate, whatever it may be. I do not want to make you sad, but I would very much like to live in your midst. God grant us that we may be allowed to achieve that." And of course, they weren't, and the husband was murdered at Auschwitz. Or another witness from the Hungarian deportations, Martin Foldy, described how at Birkenau, he had one last glimpse of his wife and children. And the it was Hausner, I believe, who was questioning him, said to him, "Well, how did you be able to recognize your wife and children?" And he said, "Well, my little girl was wearing a red coat. And so I could watch her as the line went in the other direction. I saw her red coat." Those of you who remember Schindler's List know that Steven Spielberg reprised that red coat in a different setting, but it was it's the same red coat. And then you had Kol Yisrael, Israel National Radio, was televising much of the trial, but at one point it stopped. But on the day that the resistance fighters were to come and testify, Abakovner, and the Lubetkins and others were coming to testify, it resumed broadcast. Because everyone in Israel expected this would be the moment of uplift. Now we would have the story of the people who fought back. And for the Israelis, this was part of their national image. So, of course, it made great sense. And instead of that happening, every one of the resistance fighters who testified, and these were two leaders from the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, Abakovner from the Vilna Ghetto Uprising, all spoke of the fact that what should be amazing to them is not that people didn't resist, but that there was any resistance at all. Abakovner said, "What you need for resistance is some external order, some supervising force, some national force, some group unit to call for resistance." He said, "We had nobody to call for resistance. We had to organize it on our own." He said, "What should be amazing to you is not that there weren't more revolts. What is irrational is that there was any revolt." And this was coming from Abakovner, who is a ghetto fighter and then fights in the forest, comes to Israel, is a kibbutznik and a poet. You know, all the attributes, all the qualities that Israel respects, fighter, man of letters, man of arms, kibbutznik, etc. And he stood up there and he said, "I would not testify here if I felt that there was this sense of accusation against those who did not fight back. We who fought back were the anomalies." So that was not the moment of uplift. But there were two moments of uplift. One moment was when Melchior, the father of whose son goes on to be a minister in the Israeli cabinet, but whose father had been the chief rabbi of Denmark. And it was his father who had told the people on the night of Rosh Hashanah when they came to services, "Do not go home. They had been warned by, probably by Germans or by Danish officials, we're not sure whom exactly warned the Danish Jews, don't go home, they're going to be roundup starting tonight. So people found refuge with neighbors, with friends, and they began, of course, to ferry Danish Jews across the Sound to Sweden. So Rabbi Melchior's son knew that announcement was coming on Rosh Hashanah Eve, in what I think is an expression, it was an act of maybe paying attention to authority. He went to return library books that he had at the university. I think the university could have survived without them, but he felt, and he said he was at the university only for about 10 minutes. But in the space of 10 minutes, he was approached by groups of students whom he didn't know personally, but they said, we know who you are. Here is how to get in touch with us. If you need anything, this is how you should get in touch with us. And he goes on to say that never before had the Danish people been so united as during that period when they were assisting Danish Jewry, virtually all of Danish Jewry, with only a few small exceptions, make it out to Sweden. And the other powerful moment came when Pastor Gruber, Hans Gruber, who was a pastor in Berlin and who had in his congregation many converts to Christianity from Judaism, and he often negotiated with Eichmann about these converts to get them not to be deported, to get them special permission, et cetera. And eventually he himself is put in a concentration camp. When he comes out of the concentration camp, he's so broken he can hardly walk up the steps. But he is the first non-Jewish German to testify at the trial, in fact, practically the only one. And when he was announced in the German press that he would be testifying against Eichmann, he received a thick file, he told the court, of threatening and insulting letters. But before he stepped down from the witness box, he turned to the judges and asked for permission to make a personal statement. Then he said, as the first German citizen to stand before this high court, and one who has found it hard to come here, my heartfelt entreaty is that we see forgiving love in Israel and forgiven sin in Germany, that these two shall meet before the throne of the Lord. Spectators wept. People responded. They showered him with letters. And one reporter wrote for I believe it was in the Atlantic magazine, one good man redeemed a nation. Now, I'm not sure if he redeemed the German nation, but it certainly touched the Israelis in a very, very deep way. The real battle of wits came during the cross-examination when Hausner questioned Eichmann. And if anything gives the lie to this being a show trial, it was that moment. Eichmann fought back, and sometimes he bested Hausner. And at sometimes Hausner accused him of things that he had not done. He hewed to the excuse, I was only following orders, I was not responsible, I was only following orders. And it is a battle of the wits par excellence, a battle of the wits which I'll talk about her in a moment, but which Hannah Arendt was not in the courtroom for. She was in Basel vacationing with her husband and Mary McCarthy. I really believe if she had been there, she would have written a different book. At the end of the trial in Israel, trials of this magnitude, the judges have the right to question the defendant to make sure that they fully understood everything that happened. And they begin to question Eichmann. And they push very hard. And it's at that moment that probably you have some of the most powerful moments of the trial. And it really comes at two points, but the main point is when Halevi, Judge Halevi of the Jerusalem District Court, questions Eichmann, because Eichmann kept saying, I couldn't do things on my own. I was following orders. And at one point he says to Eichmann, now you did help your aunt by marriage's daughter who was destined for deportation. She was a half Jew, a quarter Jew. To escape, and he said, yes, well, she wasn't the only one. I also helped this one to escape and that one to escape. And then Halevi paused, and with rapier sharpness, he said, so you could disregard your orders when you wanted to. And with that, his defense collapsed, because he clearly had choice, he made choices, and he made other choices. And that was, I think, for me, the most powerful moment of that exchange. What about Hannah Arendt? Well, we could have a whole session just on Hannah Arendt. Hannah Arendt got some things terribly, terribly wrong. She misunderstood the nature of the Jewish resistance. She misunderstood the role of the Jewish councils. She talked about them. She said the Jews in the ghetto faced two enemies, the Germans and the Jewish councils, who were in charge of the ghettos and organized the deportations. She painted thousands of Jewish councils with one broad brush. Some of them cooperated. Some of them did not. It depended with which council you were talking about. They varied extensively. She also got other things wrong as well. But something she got very right. And I found those exceptionally powerful. She understood that this was not simply a tragedy for the Jews, but it was a tragedy that the rest of the world had allowed to happen. She talked about how the world had stood silently by. Let me just find it for you. At one point, Abba Kovner, who was one of the main people who testified, one of my former students is here, has written about Abba Kovner, Leah Wilson from the Holocaust Museum. Abba Kovner was Israel's national poet. He was a man of resistance. As I said earlier, had all the attributes that Israelis loved. She hated his testimony because it wasn't testimony. He stood up and gave a speech, and the judges kept saying, answer the questions, and he wouldn't. He just went ahead and gave a speech. But then he reached one point in his speech where he began to talk about, the way Anton Schmidt, a German sergeant, not a high-ranking officer, whose job it had been to go through the forest and find German officers and soldiers who had been separated from the units and return them to their units. And because he had a lot of freedom to operate by himself, Schmidt helped Kovner and his fellow resistance fighters. He provided them with guns, he provided them with uniforms, he provided them with money, and he did it for no reward. He would take no reward. And Arendt describes how when Kovner began to talk about what Schmidt had done, a hush came over the courtroom. And she said it was as if the Israelis settled there, sitting there, had decided to give this brave German the 3 minutes of silence he so richly deserved, which also suggests there was noise in the courtroom otherwise, but that's beside the point. And she goes on to say, one had to think how different everything would be in this courtroom, in Europe, and in the world at large, if only more such stories could have been told. When I read that, I had read Eichmann in Jerusalem many times. When I came upon that, I said, is this a different edition? Did I miss this last time? Because that's the essence of the Holocaust. If there had been more people such as Anton Schmidt, the story would have been so different. And in that sense, she captured the moment. She also captured the moment in another way about the importance of this trial. She wrote that for the first time since the year 70, when the Romans sacked the city, the temple, Second Temple, and the city of Jerusalem, for the first time, Jews were able to sit in judgment of a non-Jew who had done them wrong. For the first time. And it's a tremendous, it's interesting. She was so severely criticized in Israel, but if ever there was a brief for a Jewish state, I think that in many respects is that brief. And then she goes on to say that Germans will tell you that most people will comply when something like this happens. She said, but the fact is some people will not. And she put that latter phrase in italics. The final solution, she goes on, could have happened in most places, but it did not happen everywhere. And she said, that's the point, that it happened, that people had a choice to stop it, had a choice not to cooperate, and failed to do so. Obviously, the trial comes down to Eichmann being found guilty. There is a great debate in Israel when the High Court is considering his appeal, whether he should be whether he should be sentenced to death or not. At one point, a group of professors from the Hebrew University, Hugo Bergman, Martin Buber, Gershon Scholem, and others, meet together, and one of the witnesses at the trial goes on to be a very famous, Yehuda Bakon, goes on to be a famous artist in Israel, meet to try to petition that the death penalty not be imposed. Other Israelis feel that's wrong and it should be imposed. At one point, Martin Buber, great teacher and philosopher and historian of Hasidut, goes over to Ben-Gurion, and he and Ben-Gurion were in a study circle together at the Prime Minister's house, studied Tanakh, Hebrew scriptures together, goes to Ben-Gurion and says, I'd like to come and see you to talk about the sentence in the Eichmann trial. Remember, it's now being appealed. Nobody knows what everyone figures the High Court is going to turn down the appeal, but the President, at the behest of the Prime Minister, has the right to overturn that. So Ben-Gurion says to Martin Buber, at that point Ben-Gurion was about 75, Martin Buber was about 83, he said, I'm older than you, I'll come to you. So he goes to Martin Buber's house, and Martin Buber tries to convince him, and Ben-Gurion does not listen. And it's quite striking, because Ben-Gurion had been opposed to the death sentence, the death penalty being included in Israeli law. This is the only Israeli law that has the death penalty. Eichmann is the only person in all of Israel on whom the death penalty has been carried out. Two were sentenced, Eichmann and Dumyanyuk. Dumyanyuk was overturned by the High Court, and only was Eichmann carried out. She missed, in that sense, and I think that going back to Arendt just for a minute, she really misses the evil which this man did. This man may not have started out as an anti-Semite, but he became an anti-Semite. And even years later, while in Argentina and doing a tape recording, he talked about how he would go into his grave happy at the fact that he had been responsible for the death of 5 to 6 million Jews. He took to his role. He tracked down every single individual Jews, not many Jews, but at one point, the Italian Foreign Office inquires of the German Foreign Office about a woman who was married to a Italian Catholic, and the Italian Catholic's father is a member of the fascist party. How this marriage ever took place, and you know, I can't imagine the courtship, but it happens. And the Italians want to know where the person is, and they just inquire. Eichmann gets the inquiry and immediately arranges to have the person deported to the death camps, lest someone in the Foreign Office rule that he be sent back to Italy. He does this over and over again. Not only goes after many, he goes after every individual that he could. So in conclusion, what does this trial accomplish? It accomplishes many things. It brings one of the chief operating officers of the Final Solution to justice. It served as a stark warning to other Nazi war criminals that they should not sleep so soundly in their beds. It retold, and almost in a way, told for the first time for the world, the history of the decimation of European Jewry. And in so doing, it accelerated the evolution of the field of Holocaust studies, amongst many other things. It gave many of the survivors the power to speak out. We now have a Holocaust museum, many of whose staff members, a number of staff members are here today. There's not a direct line from the Eichmann trial to the museum, but the Eichmann trial is the starting point. There are many other things that bring people to speak out, but this is the first time that the world hears it in such a intensive and uninterrupted fashion. But ultimately, and most importantly, it put a human face on genocide. And when I finished this writing up these remarks, and I thought of the fact that I would be appearing before people whose work is tied up with fighting genocide. And in our country, where we just took action, military action just last week, 10 days ago, to stop what we thought might be a potential mass murder. If we who live in security forget those faces, the faces of the innocent who have been designated for elimination, we do so at our own peril. You who work in this building, others who care, who work on related topics, you act on behalf of a nation And you know these faces. You've heard from these faces. You've seen these faces. We who visit the Holocaust Museum, who study, who work there, who are residents there, we know them. And something could have been done. The challenge, of course, is that it would have had to be done before it became an act of genocide. And it is in memory of those faces and the determination not to have that happen again, though it has happened so many times since then, rather than never again, it's been again and again and again, that I'd like to close by reading you a story that happened to me, and this is the close of the book. A number of years ago, I was invited to a conference at Yad Vashem. While there, I met a group of young Rwandans who had asked Yad Vashem to train them and how to conduct oral testimonies with trauma victims. They wanted to ensure that the history of the genocide that had decimated their country and their families would be preserved. Yad Vashem, eager to make them comfortable, arranged for them to have dinner on their first night in Jerusalem with French-speaking Holocaust survivors. By the end of the dinner, the two groups of survivors had bonded so strongly that the elderly survivors took the young Rwandans under their wings, invited them to their home, introduced them to their families, and began to build personal relations, also wreaking havoc on the schedule, but that's beside the point. One afternoon, I sat with some of the young Rwandans outside of Yad Vashem, looking out over the Judean hills. They told me of their experiences during the genocide and their meeting with Holocaust survivors. One young man whose entire family had been murdered said to me, "I want to tell my story and help my fellow Rwanda survivors tell theirs, just like the Holocaust survivors. I want people to listen to me as they listen to them." Despite the inherent contradiction in his next statement, I completely understood what he meant and recognized the passion with which he said it, for I had heard it many times from Holocaust survivors. Future generations, those who were not there, must remember. And we who were there must tell them. This may be the most enduring legacy of what occurred in Jerusalem in 1961. Thank you very much. Question? Thank you.
Deborah, thank you for telling their stories and telling yours. There is time for a few questions. There are microphones on either side for any that may have questions. I'd like to start it off, however, taking the advantage of the microphone, to ask this. You've been through it all with Holocaust denial, and you know that the phenomenon of Holocaust denial is growing. What impact is this book, the notoriety it's already gotten in the New York Times and bestseller lists, and is sure to have,
yes,
Halavai, right. But what impact that's going to have, and advice for us who travel the world and hear voices that question everything that you've put your academic scholarship and reputation to.
Thank you, Hannah. Thank you for that question. It's interesting that you say that, because when people ask me what I was working on after I had finished my previous book, History on Trial, which was, of course, completely about Holocaust denial and my own trial, I said to people, I'm working on a new topic on the Eichmann trial. I've left denial. And they said, that's what you think. And, of course, I thought they were all wrong, but I think they were right, though I've never told them so, because that would be counter to my personality. I don't remember who they were anyway. And I think the two do tie together. The fact is that, let me give you a logical answer and an illogical answer, and you will understand the illogical answer, Hannah, because you deal with it all the time. The logical answer, of course, is that no Nazi war criminal, not one, has ever denied what they said they did. Even when they knew they were facing a certain death sentence, did they deny it? They said things such as, Eichmann, I did this, but of course I was not responsible, I was only following orders, all sorts of claims such as that. So I think in documenting this, and you hear this over and over again, and Eichmann could have made that his defense, well, what didn't happen, it wasn't so bad, et cetera, not at Nuremberg, no one ever denies it. But the truth of the matter is, neither this book nor my previous books on Holocaust denial, nor my work on Holocaust denial, is directed at deniers. There's no changing the minds of a denier. A denier, there's no change in the mind of a racist. They are purveyors of and captives of prejudice. And if you think of the word prejudice, think of the etymology of the word prejudice. Prejudge. I've made up my mind. Don't confuse me with the facts. I see a Jew. I know someone who's rich and powerful. I see a person of color, an African American, whatever. I know they're shiftless and lazy, as the canard goes. I see an Italian. I know mafioso. I see a pretty blonde young woman. I often say this to my students when I'm talking about prejudice, and I said, "What's the accusation?" And they all laugh and say, "Stupid." I said, "It's part of that same process. It's an illogical phenomenon." So anybody who adheres to it, anybody who espouses it, anybody who works to spread it, is acknowledging or is taking part in something that is inherently illogical. So my work, this book, my work on Holocaust denial, my website that Emory has set up on Holocaust denial, H. Is not designed to change the mind of the deniers. That's farfallen, you know, that's useless, as some of our grandparents would say. That's just it's putting your finger in the dike. It's to protect those, you know, if David Irving is sitting in 7A on that flight and you happen to be unlucky enough to be in 7B, it's to inoculate, it's to give you the information, the knowledge, the understanding to understand his modus operandi, to understand how the deniers try to twist the information. So I think in that sense, I'm here today, I'm talking a lot about the book, but essentially at heart I'm a teacher. And it's what I do, you know, every semester in my classroom at Emory, what I'll do with my freshmen next semester, and, you know, in general classes on the history of the Holocaust, is to teach the facts, just the facts, and to give the students the information. I'm not going to change. I'm not going to waste my time trying to change the minds of those who hate, because they're motivated by hate. It's a passion that they have, and nothing will convince them. And in fact, the irony is amongst the deniers, they say it wasn't 6 million, but the Jews were so terrible they deserved to have this happen to them. And in talking to many people, survivors from Rwanda, I know there's Rwanda genocide denial. You know all this. You in this building know this better. If it's inconvenient history, let's try to rewrite it and let's try to change it. So, question? Yes.
Hello. My name is Melissa, and I actually work with Hannah. My question, thank you very much for coming today. It was just really moving. My question for you is, obviously today there was a good amount of emotion in the room when you spoke and you read your book. But with the CNN effect, I know that when I try to talk to so many of my peers about genocides and mass killings and things like that, you know, it's just a number to them. And people have become so desensitized because of that. So I was wondering what advice you give to future generations.
Oh, God, if I had an answer to that, you know, I would put it down in stone and retire. I think, even in telling the story today, I focused, and I do more so in the book, on individual stories. The little boy who was so proud he was saving the biscuit for his mother, and then as soon as Rene Bloom stroked his face and he had some kindness, he broke into tears. Or Martin Foldy watching his daughter in her little red coat. Or the woman, Margit Reich, who I didn't talk about that, but who receives the letter. I did actually. The letter from her husband. The individual stories. That The magnitude of what happened, the number of victims, is certainly overwhelming. 6 million, and now with everything we've learned from the former Soviet Union archives, possibly more than that. And I leave that to the historians from the Holocaust Museum to work on. But it's easy to get lost in the magnitude. And I think that's why it's so important to remind people it's individual stories. It's one by one by one. And to that somehow to capture that that moment. That's the most I can do. I don't know if we're, and the facts, you know, just the facts, just the facts, as Sergeant Friday used to say on Dragnet, only to the women. just the facts, because the facts, there's no need to aggrandize. There's no need to speak with overwrought emotion. I've learned that over the years. The facts scream out in a still, small voice. They scream out that their blood, to paraphrase the prophet, cries out from the earth. The Hebrew scriptures, their blood cries out from the earth, but it's the story of individuals, and that's all you can hope for.
Thank you.
Yes, please, Doug.
Deborah, I'm curious if you'll reflect for a moment on the phenomenon of a trial as a mechanism for achieving justice while also creating a historical record, mm-hmm. because that's a lot of what you attribute to the Eichmann trial, and yet, of course, they are two different functions. Historians seek truth. Courts ultimately resolve disputes. So you've experienced one trial as a historian. You experienced another in a very different way, and I suspect...
Defendant.
Yes.
Use the word.
and I suspect in that context you spent more than a few evenings worrying that maybe the wrong result would obtain.
Certainly in my trial in England, I worried about that a lot. And even though my attorney, Anthony Julius, and my barrister, Richard Rampton, assured me that the facts are on our side, I worried that we would get on the one hand, sort of a wishy-washy kind of judgment from the judge, because that's how I was told British judges tended to, he did this, but it wasn't, whatever. I didn't expect the ruling that we got, and it was quite overwhelming. But I was very worried about history in the courtroom, because history doesn't belong in the courtroom. That's not how historians operate. But I think in this case, of course, the judges, even Hannah Arendt loves them. She loves them, of course, because they're Germans. It's quite clear. She says that, and they're the best of German jury, while Hausner is a Galician Jew. Of course, her mother was a Russian Jew, but we don't talk about that. But in any case, I think that the one mistake the judges in the Eichmann trial got in their ruling, they said we're ignoring. If there were close to 100 survivors who give testimony, said those testimonies will be of importance to historians. They're not of importance to us. We're judging him on the documents, and based on the documents, he is guilty. The irony is that, yes, the documents, those were the Nuremberg documents, by and large. But the irony is that the legacy of the trial is those testimonies. So there you had that testimony in the courtroom. Here's another irony. In my trial, after the Eichmann trial, in virtually every war crimes trial, including those having nothing to do with the Holocaust, whether it's the former Yugoslavia, Rwanda, Congo, you have the first person singular, the voice of the survivor, testifying. It puts that human face on genocide that wasn't there in Nuremberg and therefore failed on some level of other reasons as well to capture the world's imagination. In my trial, we made a decision not to put survivors on the stand, even though many of them came to us and volunteered. We didn't explain why. We had a number of reasons for doing so. One of them, from a forensic point of view or legal point of view, was that we did not want my trial with David Irving suing me for libel to turn into a did the Holocaust happen trial. We wanted to say to the court, the Holocaust happened, it's an established fact. We don't have to bring witnesses of fact, which is what survivors would have been, to the test to prove that this happened. We're taking that it happened. We will now prove that this man is a denier by looking at what he said and how he twisted the truth. But that was the first war crimes trial since the Eichmann trial that didn't, or war crime related trial. But to go back to your question, history doesn't belong in the courtroom. But certainly in these two cases, and maybe to end on this point, in these two cases, as a historian, I can say history performed exceptionally well, and so did the courtrooms. I want to thank you all for coming. I want to especially thank my colleagues from Emory, and thank you, Hannah.